Exhibition. It's also nice to be here because of your city of culture. I'm not quite sure whether the city of culture is Valletta or the whole of Malta. But somebody can put me straight about that eventually. But I have a little experience with cities of culture, and they can be wonderful occasions. I was involved in Derry City of Culture in 2013, which was a wonderful experience. I gave a number of talks, and that's better. You're welcome. A little bit of light would be good. Thank you. I must say that the sense of city, in the case of Derry, being celebrating on a kind of European scale was very exciting. I hope you're having a good time in your city of culture here in Malta. In a way, that's the starting point for the idea of talking about Caravaggio and cinema. It seems to be a subject that can bring together very seemingly different subjects, kinds of work in I hope, a fruitful way. Now, I call this cheating because, in a way, it's important to say, and I will be saying in various ways, that when people play Caravaggio or invoke Caravaggio in the 20th and 21st century, in a sense, they're cheating. You've had long enough to see this, and that's a prime example of kind of image which is pretty widely distributed across the web. You will probably have seen images like that, where people often take as an exercise, let's recreate a painting. And there are many examples of this. Caravaggio has suffered, like many great painters. But to be more precise about cinema's relationship to Caravaggio, if you look at interviews with cinematographers, cameramen, DPs as they're called, let's call them cinematographers, you will find that a very large number of them refer to Caravaggio. It's become a cliche. Here we are. Key artistic influences? Caravaggio, of course. I could give you many examples of that. It's become a sort of mantra among cinematographers that the one high culture reference that they can use is Caravaggio. It's even filtered down to film school. So here is a task set to film students writing a hotel room crime scene on the shoestring. It's a crime genre film. Suggested some films from John Alton and a Caravaggio punctuated by the style. Now, you can think different things about that. You can think, how banal, how ridiculous, how stupid. Do they understand Caravaggio? Do they understand lighting? But the point, I think, is that Caravaggio has become a cipher for chiaroscuro lighting. I'm going to explore that a little bit in more colors. Here is another of those examples. Here's another cinematographer, Harris Savides, who's made some quite significant shots and quite significant films. American Gangster, Zodiac, for instance, quite an impressive filmography. And he doesn't cite Caravaggio as his main influence. He takes De La Tour. De La Tour. Now, and here, for instance, is this comes from his website. This is his reference point, the dice player for the tour, and the film that he lit called Birth. Very obvious use of in image, light sources, deep shadows, etc. We've got to make some distinctions here to make sense of this relationship. Are we talking about specific influences of Caravaggio, or the more general influence of Caravaggio? Which developed historically in the later Baroque and led to a broader movement often called the Tenebrist movement, which would include De La Tour. In other words, painters who dealt in low-light tableau and scenes, wide spectrum across many countries, by no means confined to Italy, but in France and even into Britain. Joseph Wright, for instance, would be a Tenebrist in that sense. Another aspect of this, of course, would be the influence of Caravaggio's actual paintings, his subjects, on biblical and religious subjects in cinema. Caravaggio's choice of models, choice of costume, his presentism in his representation of biblical scenes. That is surely something that will find an influence on the representation of biblical scenes in cinema. So those are some of the distinctions we could make. But, as I say, there's quite a trend towards the recreation of a sort of Caravaggismo in photography. There's many, many suites of pictures like this, which are imitations of well-known Caravaggio paintings. And this is a particular photographer who advertises his work as specifically in the style of Caravaggio. This is a portrait of Patrick Stewart, the actor, which he's offering a pretty high price. You can have Patrick Stewart, Caravaggio style. So it's a cultural phenomenon. Of course, there are many such trends. If you take Rembrandt as an example, you will find that there's an enormous range of references to Rembrandt in the work of photographers, stylistic analysis of all kinds. So it's by no means confined to Caravaggio. Let's put a little bit of art history into this, just as a kind of anchoring point. There was a very interesting exhibition held at the National Gallery in London a few years ago called Beyond Caravaggio, which Keith, I think, was involved in and certainly spoke at one of the lectures that accompanied the exhibition. And this comes from the National Gallery's website. This is how the National Gallery described to potential patrons the origins of Caravaggio, as it's known in English. Now, I'm going to make a turn into cinema. We're going to really spend most of the rest of this talk looking at aspects of film history and film analysis. And where do we start? Well, we start really with the fact that cinema, of course, was an affair of photography. Photography, technology developed in the 19th century, was available light photography. There was very little or no artificial light used in photography for most of the 19th century. Beginning of the 20th century, when animated photography became film, filming was also conducted in open-air situations, using reflected sunlight at most, but essentially using available light. Then something quite important happens in the early teens. This is the moment at which film lighting is born. It happens quite specifically in 1915. 1915, Cecil B. DeMille, seen here on the right. This is a later image of DeMille, but I chose it because he's posing with some film equipment, starts to use Klieg lighting. It's the first form of artificial light that begins to be used in Los Angeles, becoming Hollywood in 1915. This is one of the first films that DeMille shot in 1915, called The Captive, using artificial light. And of course, in the context that I've been talking, we could look at it and say, yes, there are sort of Caravaggesque qualities to this particular composition. He's using chiaroscuro because he can now create deep shadows and can light faces and selected parts of the picture. Where does it come from? Well, it has its own micro history. It comes from the work of David Velasco. What you have there is a cartoon from the 1911, 1912, which shows David Velasco in the lighting gallery of one of the New York theaters. Velasco was a great pioneer of dramatic lighting on stage. He invented a whole genre of melodrama. He staged the plays that would become the operas of Puccini, Madame Butterfly. But lighting was absolutely crucial to Velasco's work. And he made use of the new forms of high-intensity lighting to punch through from a great distance away from the stage and create very strong lighting effects. And of course, shadows. So basically, what De Niro was doing is taking Velasco lighting and applying it to cinema.